Because the duty is to reinstall the glory, to establish it in its original form, unalloyed form, in a safeguarded, fortified manner. That is what we call samsthapana, samsthapaka. So we need the rule of samsthapakas now. That is the present era. And how the civilization it develops and how we are going to do that? Civilization has two extensions. One is culture and second is heritage. Civilization is innate maturity of status, and when it extends into behavioral manifestation in forms of both intellectual and psychological dimensions, it becomes culture. When it is preserved over time, where it can adapt all circumstances and remain unalloyed and pure, where it can dominate any circumstances, any person, it can face any hurdles and withstand, that is known as heritage. So there are two extensions for civilization. Civilization can manifest, whatever the psychological manifestations of the civilization in the form of culture, brotherhood, magnanimity, forgiving other people, upliftment of the humanity, empathy and sympathy towards the fellow beings, these are the psycho-behavioral extensions. What are the epistemological extensions or manifestations? Understanding about everything. Ontology, understanding about the base. Teleology, understanding about the purpose of life. Epistemology, understanding the origination of knowledge. Theology, understanding the nature of God. Eschatology, understanding the life after death and eternity. Metaphysics, understanding indriyatita anubhuti, that which is beyond the purview of senses. Thaumatology, understanding about the paranormal senses. Aratology, understanding about the divine principles. Agathology, understanding of the philosophy of the sin and virtue. So these things are the intellectual manifestations. Apart from which, there are also these things are known as subtle intellectual manifestations. There are also tangible manifestations in the form of navigation, aeronautical engineering, construction engineering, textiles and designing, ornamental studies. So we have a lot of such things. Those civilizations are always mentioned and studied and considered by people as, yes, pottery was there, ornamental things were there, script was there, language was there. These things are not just mere measures of civilization. These things come under the tangible intellectual manifestations of culture. So there are innumerable things like this. So apart from which this tangible and subtle intellectual and psychological manifestations, we come to heritage. Heritage, I already told, it is a continuous flow. And it creates an impact, and nobody can create an impact inside it. That type of sturdity in our culture is known as heritage, and we are calling it by the name of heritage, Indian heritage if you call, then there is a meaning inside it. And there are two things which I want to say here. Number one, that which is subjected to continuous growth and modification, that which is immutable. Whatever we see in the world that is overruled by a second model, even in electronics you know that. Whatever any productivity that comes in the form of any product or any apparatus or any other design that is overruled by a similar design or a salient model or some more advanced and upgraded systems, you are seeing that. But this type of thing, what we call nitya, niravadya, nirakhyata, nishkalanga, satya, all of these words, sanatana, all of these words, they denote that it is immutable and it is eternal. It cannot be overruled by anything, it is irreplaceable. And there is nothing equal to that. It is krisama gradika. It has no equivalence or excellence. So that is the greatness of our status. So we have some model. Why we are talking about our civilization? We have crossed the civilization over thousands of years. Still we are talking about that. Because of the reason that, number one, that is eternal and that is very much required now emergently. So because of two reasons, one is of eternity, second is of emergence. That is the only solution for the problems that we face with us, with others, and others face with us. So all the global predicament of systems or structures, they have only one solution, and the solution is to repatriate ourselves to practically implementing the civilization inside our wheels, not by an epidemic ointment or coverage. Practically making it intravenous. So having a pragmatic approach towards our civilization to rebring the power of the glory of our tradition is the work that we are going to do now. And for that there are a lot of hindrances. We have to understand the problem analysis or failure investigation as well as the success studies. We have to understand the problems in society. Number one, what we have now is present scenario, we have no power for deeper transformations. There is no possibility for deeper transformation because of the reason that we have more belief than power. Power is different from belief. A person having the power of money can achieve things with money. A person just believes in money cannot achieve it. No doubt belief is the threshold for everything. You must believe God, you must practice it in the form of worship, you must accomplish your worship, then it becomes a power. Power creates your ability to do things and also to authorize people to do things. Now most of the people who are going to temples, they are just asking us, having a belief, taking a divine shelter for their problems or justification of their mistakes or evasion from the sins committed knowingly or unknowingly. So such type of people basically blended with just belief cannot be powerful receptacles as well as producers who are required for renaissance of this glory. What are the powers? How we can accumulate that power? Shastra says it is panchanga. One is ritual, by performing the kratus we can do that. And number two, by meditation, by dhyana we can do that. Upasana, by selecting a deity and by chanting mantra several times, we can do that. And nididhyasana, by understanding something from the Upanishads and following the Vedic view of deeper meditation, that is actually different. Even though that is also a type of meditation, that is actually different. Worshipping Brahman is known as nididhyasana. And taking a deity and chanting the mantras and following the system of worship is known as upasana, which is contemplation. And the third type of thing is dhyana. Just continue to think about the structure of abstract. So that is good. So these rituals, these various modes of worship, practicing austerity. Austerity in food, austerity in the strength of senses. You have to follow a lot of things like that. So this is the power mechanism inside our religion. So if you are not following these rituals, not having any upasana, not having any dhyana or anything else, not having achara and anushtana, where is the possibility of getting that power? If you are not having the power, what is the difference between Satyam Veda that is given in our Vedas and the same thing given in the ethical treatises and other religious treatises? We have to get the power to speak the truth. We have to get the power to make others also to speak the truth. We have the power to face the problems while we are speaking the truth. We have to see that we sustain in speaking the truth. To that we have to gain some power. The power is gained only by these practices. So the practices, if they are not there, then there is no use for them. Moreover, now the society is having one more problem. That is what we call religio-industrial complex. Anything starting from your parrot astrology, vastu, everything. There are innumerable bindings in the religion. People are very much confused which is a real religion, which is having the real Vedic affinity or loyalty, and which is something intruded, which is reliable, which is accountable. So there is a lot of confusion because there is no checkup mechanism. So innumerable things, innumerable worships which are not regularized, and various things in the name of the same religion is there. It is known as religio-industrial multi-level complex. So lot of people they are inside and they don't have any authentic membership, they don't have any touch with the heritage, they don't have anything to do with the knowledge of our system, but still as a beneficiary they are getting into different things and they are considering the same system to be Purna. That is known as Brahma. Brahma is a confused state by a person having a part of a system where he is mistaking that part of the system to be the complete system. Thereby he is denying the opportunity to access the real value of the system and to be a proper supporter for the religion or the system and its development. That is the problem with the religio-industrial multi-level complex. And moreover, we are having a lot of people, but those people, they are not vivifiers. We used to define these people, so-called religious people, into three stages. The first person is a ground supporter. Those who are telling Srimad Ramayana, Bhagavata, either it may be a cine play or it may be a dramatic play or it may be even a katha kalakshepa, a lecture or discourse. Those people, they are giving you a ground for your belief. They are known as blind ground producers or providers. The second level of people, they structure and shape you. Those people, they deal with Upanishad. Those people, they give explanations about various intricacies of life. What is the greatness of one philosophy? There are three greatnesses. One, it is universally applicable. Number two, it is eternally, it is relevant. Number three, it can answer any question. That which is having three powers. One is the power of cultivation. Second is the power of clarification. Third is the power of conviction. That which can cultivate divinity inside you and clarify all the doubts that are against the installation of divinity, and that which can bring you real, genuine, unfading conviction inside your mind. That is known as knowledge. So that type of knowledge can be provided by these people, those who are structuring and shaping you. But what we want is a vivifier. Vivifier is a strong spiritual spirit. A very great Mahapurusha, what we call Rishis. So such people, vivifiers, they only can do things. That's what we used to also call, there is a skeleton, there is a stuff inside, there is a skin and there is a spirit. Then only it can become a perfect organism. Whatever we speak in this mic or before